إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليمًا كثيرًا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالًا كثيرًا ونساءً، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كلام الله تعالى، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. أعاذنا الله وإياكم وجميع المسلمين من البدع والضلالات والنار، آمين. All the praises for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. We praise Him, seek His assistance and beseech Him for His forgiveness. We seek refuge with Allah from the evils of our own souls and from the evils of our actions. Indeed, whomsoever Allah Most High guides, there is no one that can lead him astray. And whomsoever Allah Most High sends astray, then there is no one that can guide him. I testify that there is none worthy of worship except Allah alone without any partner. And I testify that our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the slave and messenger of Allah. We ask Allah to bestow His choicest salutations, peace and blessings on our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his family and companions. O you who believe, fear Allah as He ought to be feared, and do not die except in a state of submission to Allah as Muslims. O people, fear your Lord who created you from a single being, and from Him created His spouse, and from the two of them brought forth men and women in abundance. Fear Allah through whom you ask your rights, and keep the family ties, and indeed Allah is ever watchful over you. O you who believe, fear Allah and speak a word that is true and just. Allah will rectify for you your deeds and forgive you your sins, and whosoever obeys Allah and His Messenger has attained the ultimate success. Indeed, the truest of speech is the speech of Allah Most High. And the best of guidance is the guidance of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And the worst of affairs are novelties in the religion, and every such novelty is a heresy, a bid'ah. And every bid'ah is misguidance, and every misguidance is in the fire. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to save us and all the Muslims from the innovations, the misguidance, and the fire. Ameen. Ibadallah, inna منصب الإفتاء في الإسلام منصب عظيم. Indeed, أيها الإخوة, the position or the amanah of إفتاء, of giving religious verdicts and answers in Islam, is a great and a heavy position. لا يتساهل فيه إلا جاهل ظالم لنفسه. And no one takes it lightly and is negligent with regards to it except the one who is ignorant and oppressive to himself. And the one who gives answers to people in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without knowledge, and gives rulings to people in the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala without shar'i knowledge, without ilm, then that person is wronging himself, is doing an injustice to himself, and he has not estimated this position and this amana correctly. And he will also bring about the injustice with regards to the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in that he may lead them astray. And our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned about this. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed us its tahrim, its prohibition, and its enormity in the Quran. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, قُلْ إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّيَ الْفَوَاحِشَ مَا ظَهَرَ مِنْهَا وَمَا بَطَنَ وَالْإِثْمَ وَالْبَغْيَ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ وَأَنْ تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ نُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا وَأَنْ تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, say to them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, say, my Lord has made prohibited. And Allah says, إِنَّمَا حَرَّمَ رَبِّي, to show the importance of these matters and the graveness of these matters. That he has prohibited only these things. Meaning how severely prohibited it is and how enormous a sin it is for a person to commit it. But he said, Al-Fawahish, the illicit shameful deeds, the illicit shameful deeds, fornication and adultery, ma dhahara minna wa ma batan, that which is apparent and made known from it and that which is hidden. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it haram. And it is a major sin. وَالْإِثْمَ وَالْبَغْيَ بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ, and sinfulness, to constantly transgress against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's laws and overstep his boundaries. And al-baghi, to commit injustice and oppression unto others. بِغَيْرِ الْحَقِّ, without having the right to transgress against them. And Allah says this because we know in Al-Islam that when a person is transgressed against, he has the right to transgress in like manner. Although Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala made it praiseworthy for him to forego it, but he has the right to take retaliation. This is bilhaq. This is what the right. Allah has prohibited transgression and oppression without due right. وَأَن تُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ نُنَزِّلْ بِهِ سُلْطَانًا, and that to ascribe unto Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as partners that for which He has given no authority, that you make shirk with Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. وَأَن تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ, and that you say about Allah that which you do not know. That you say about Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala that which you have no knowledge of. That you speak in the deen of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala without ilm. That you give rulings and say this is haram and this is halal and this is makruh and this, subhanallah, is mustahab. Whatever ruling you give without knowledge. And the ulama are clear that this is all encompassed in it. As Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala, he said, with regards to speaking about Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya Allah is speaking about Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Al-Hafidh Ibn Hajar, he said, it encompasses every ruling of the Sharia. Everything which you say, with regards to what is haram or what is halal, any ruling that you give, based upon a lie upon Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, then you are also lying against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You are lying against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam only speaks what Allah commands him to speak. And only gives the rulings Allah ta'ala commands him to give. So Allah has prohibited that you speak about him without knowledge. That you speak about his deen, about his sharia, about that which he has legislated without ilm. And only a jahil, only an ignorant person, he won't recognize the severity of this. We are people, alhamdulillah, who strive to better ourselves in religious knowledge. And every class, every dars, every halaqah of ilm, of knowledge we go to, we strive to increase it, and every Jum'ah we strive to learn and implement what has been said. But as for those who are negligent with regards to knowledge, then they don't recognize the danger of speaking without it. They don't recognize the danger of speaking without it. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made this completely haram and showed us that it is from the major sins. Imagine, ayyuha al-ikhwa, it is mentioned immediately after shirk. وَأَنْتُشْرِكُوا بِاللَّهِ مَا لَمْ يُنَزِلْ بِسُلْطَانَ That you ascribe as partners unto Allah that which He gave no authority for. وَأَنْ تَقُولُوا عَلَى اللَّهِ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ And that you say about Allah Ta'ala that which you do not know. Immediately after shirk, Allah Ta'ala mentions this. Speaking about the deen of Allah, Tabaraka wa Ta'ala, without knowledge. How serious were the ulama of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah from the Sahaba and the Tabi'een and the Imams of Deen who followed them with regards to this? How serious were they with regards to this? That Imam Malik rahimahullah ta'ala, Imam Dar al-Hijrah, Imam Dar al-Hijrah, and the Imam and teacher of many of the Imams of Islam, that he said rahimahullah ta'ala, I did not give a fatwa and sit down to teach the people. حتى شهد لي 70 من علماء أهل المدينة. Until 70 of the ulama of Medina gave witness for me. I did not sit down to give them fatwa. Until 70 of the ulama of Medina gave witness and testified for me. Until they vouched that he is a scholar that can teach the people. That he is someone that can give fatawa. And this is why it is narrated even from the Imams of the Salaf. And they would use the statement, subhanAllah, up until this day, the scholars still use it. That when a fatwa was asked to one of the ulama of Medina, whilst Imam Malik was there, they would say, Ayufta wa Malik fil Medina. They would say, is fatwa given whilst Malik is in Medina? Is fatwa given, yani by anyone else, while Malik is in Medina? He's the most knowledgeable, go to him. Yani we will not give a fatwa whilst our Imam, our teacher and our Sheikh is there. This was the way of the ulama and the imams of our deen. It's the way of the ulama of our deen and the imams of our deen, those who have knowledge, and those who know the status and the value of knowledge. And subhanAllah, I said up until today, and I have witnessed it, that one of the scholars has asked a question, and a more senior scholar, in fact, who is younger than him, but who is known to be more knowledgeable than him. So they ask him, and the Sheikh has passed away, rahimahullah ta'ala, and they ask him a question in the presence of the Sheikh who is there. And he said, Ayufta wa Malik fil Medina? He said, this fatwa given whilst Malik is in Medina, and he pointed to the other Sheikh. And this is known from the Sahaba radiallahu ta'ala anhum. That when a question was asked to one of them, he would direct the person to another Sahabi and say, go to him, فَإِنَّهُ أَعْلَمُ مِنِّي. Go to him, he's more knowledgeable than me. And they would go to the next person and he would direct them to another Sahabi and he would say, go to him, فَإِنَّهُ أَعْلَمُ مِنِّي. He is more knowledgeable than me. And sometimes that person would go to a number of Sahaba until he is pointed back to the first Sahabi. And when he came back to him and he asked him the question, he found that now it is a necessity for me, I must answer it. They saw the severity. They saw the greatness of this amana, this trust of knowledge that Allah Ta'ala has placed upon them. That it is not something to be taken lightly, that everyone, كل من هب ودب, everyone who is to and fro, everyone who is حاطب الليل, who can take يعني, the gatherer of sticks at night, you can get, gather somewhere from Google and everywhere and you can give a fatwa, no. Subhanallah, they were serious about ilm. And they were afraid of speaking about the deen of Allah without ilm. Unlike the muftis of today. Unlike the muftis of today, who give fatawa against the speech of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Fatawa that is contradicted clearly by the Quran. Fatawa that is contradicted by the sahih sunnah of our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine that you're telling someone to do something contradicting the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And you do it, subhanallah, like one of the ulama said, like a person who is drinking cool water. So easy for you. Give a fatwa against the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Contradicting the sunnah of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Whilst all the imams were so afraid, that they would say, إِذَا صَحَّ الْحَدِيثِ فَهُوَ مَذْهَبِي. If the hadith is sahih, that's my madhab. If the hadith is sahih, that's my madhab. If it comes from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that's my opinion. But Imam Shafi rahimahullah ta'ala said, إِذَا قُلْتُ بِقَوْلٍ. If I said any statement, فَوَجَدْتُمْ فِي سُنَّةِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ مَا يُخَالِفُ قَوْلِي فَضْرِي بِقَوْلِي أَرْضَ الْحَائِطِ. He said, if I said anything, any opinion, and you find in the sunnah of Rasulullah صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ that which contradicts what I said, then take what I said and throw it against the wall. Take what I said and throw it against the wall. And in his risalah, in the risalah of Imam Shafi'i, the first book compiled and written in usul al-fiqh, in the foundations and fundamentals of deriving the ahkam of the sharia, Imam Shafi'i rahimahullah ta'ala, he said the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has authority over the statements of all of mankind. Because Allah has not given anyone in mankind what He gave Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So it is not allowed for you to put the statement of anyone above the sunnah of our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Iftah bi ghayri ilm, giving fatwas without knowledge, is extremely dangerous, ya ibadallah. If the scholars are afraid, the ulama and the a'imma are afraid, what about us? What about us who have a drop in the ocean of their knowledge? How afraid must we be? Yet our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he described the situation that we are in clearly. He described the situation that we are in clearly when he said sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the hadith which is agreed upon by Bukhari and Muslim from Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As radiallahu ta'ala anhuma, that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَقْبِدُ الْعِلْمَ إِنْتِزَاعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will not take away the knowledge, snatching it away. يَنْتَزِعُ مِنْ صُدُورِ النَّاسِ, snatching it away from the hearts of people. وَلَكِنْ بِقَبْدِ الْعُلَمَاءِ. However, he will take it away by the death of the ulama. He will take the knowledge away by the death of the scholars. حَتَّى لَمْ يُبْقِ عَالِمًا. Until no scholar is left to remain. اتَّخَذَ النَّاسُ رُؤُوسًا جُهَالًا. The people will take ignorant leaders. فَسُئِلُوا فَأَفْتَوْا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا. And they will be asked, and they will give fatwas without knowledge. And so they will go astray, and they will lead others astray. Wallahi, this is our reality that we live. That the ulama, there are few, wallahi. The ulama in every place, there are few. And subhanallah, the kibar, most senior ulama, there are even less. يعلمنا الناس from amongst the ulama. And when you look at who the people have taken as ulama, you are shocked and amazed. And these muftis are questioned, they are asked questions, they are put in the manasik, they are put in the stations, and the positions of ifta, of giving religious verdicts. Giving religious verdicts. فَسُئِلُوا, they are questioned, فَأَفْتَوُوا بِغَيْرِ عِلْمٍ, and they give fatwa without knowledge. فَضَلُوا وَأَضَلُوا, so they go astray and they lead others astray. Can you imagine fatawa making permissible for women that which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam cursed? That which Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam cursed. That which he mentioned from the description of the woman of hellfire. You make it permissible for them to take these descriptions. You give fatwa that it is permissible. What are you, subhanAllah, what are you doing? You are leading them astray. Because you are astray. Because you have given fatwa without knowledge. And so you lead people to their destruction without knowledge. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned about it. Giving fatwa, making musical instruments in the masjid permissible. Making it permissible, not even restricting it, leaving it up to the people. This is a fatwa. That whatever you think you can take into the masjid, it's fine, you can take it into the masjid. A'udhu billah. This is ifta. This is people who ask for fatwas on the radio to which thousands of Muslims are listening. And the answer is whatever instrument you feel you can take in the masjid, it's okay, you can take it. Subhanallah, al-iftah bighayri ilm, giving fatwas without knowledge. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, فَضَلُّوا وَأَضَلُّوا, they will be astray and they will lead others astray. This is the reality, أيها الإخوة. وَمِنْ عَلَامَاتِ السَّاعَةِ, and from the signs of the hour, that our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam directed us to. He said, أَنْ يَقِلَّ الْعِلْمِ وَيَكْثُرَ الْجَهْلِ. He said that knowledge will become scarce and little, and ignorance will become widespread. Ignorance will become widespread. That people rejoice in such ignorant fatawa, because they too have no knowledge of the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because they too will not go back to the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and look at his ahadith and look at the sunnah and verify whether this person has spoken the truth. Because they too will not go to the Quran and look at what Allah ta'ala said, because the mufti has given them a fatwa that suits their desires. So the ignorance has become widespread, and the muftis that lead people astray, subhanAllah, they are the ones that take, and they take the manasib, they take the positions. SubhanAllah, even shabab, young ones, subhanAllah, who they are weak in their knowledge, they are weak even in the language of the Sharia, they don't even know the names of the books that they are quoting from or the scholars that they mention. And they're sitting on the radio and they're giving fatawa on marriage and on talaq. Fatawa on marriage and on talaq. And even recently I heard even women calling the woman and asking them about marriage and talaq. This was a day or two ago on the radio. That they are giving the fatawa. They are saying, no, the talaq will be like this and like this and whatever the case may be. A'udhu billah. Speaking about the deen of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala without knowledge is a major sin. It is a major sin. And a matter as serious as marriage and talaq. A matter as serious as this. Look at the state of the tabi'een. Rahimahumullah ta'ala jami'an. As they said, إذا سُئِلَ فِي الطَّلَاقِ when it was questioned regarding talaq, when it was questioned regarding talaq, sakata ahlul madina kulluhum illa ibn al-musayyib. When a question was asked about talaq, the people of Medina would keep quiet except for Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib rahimahullah ta'ala. No one would give a verdict in talaq except Sa'id ibn al-Musayyib, this great imam of the tabi'in. No one else would speak about the matter because he was known to have the most knowledge in it. Today everyone speaks about it. Everyone speaks about it. Subhanallah, even the man who's not married, the youngster who's never been married, he speaks about the matters of marriage and marriage counseling and talaq and subhanallah, no experience in the matter. And they lead the ummah to calamities. They lead the ummah to misguidance and to destruction. And if only they adhered to this warning of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that Allah made haram for people to speak about Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala without knowledge. And if only they remain silent and taken to the advice of Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, that Imam Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu, this great khalifa, the fourth khalifa of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, "Asamtu hikmah wa qalilun fa'ilun." He said, silence is wisdom, but few are those who practice it. Silence is wisdom, but few are those who practice it. Our Nabi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam kana tawila samt. He sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would remain silent for long periods of time. Our mother Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she tells us, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would remain silent for long periods of time. Then when he used to speak, he spoke with words that if a person was to count it, he would count it. If he was to count it, he would count it. Not like today, ayyuha al-ikhwa, where everyone wants to speak and they seek out every platform to speak and they seek to speak in matters yani which is shaz, matters which is contradicting or that which is different to the vast majority of people just to seek attention. Or they do things which contradict the sunnah just to seek attention, whilst they know the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Subhanallah, if they knew the danger, wallahi they would refrain. If the Mufti knew the danger of speaking about Allah without knowledge and he's asked a question, he would act like Imam Malik did, rahimahullah ta'ala, when some person traveled from far to Imam Malik, rahimahullah ta'ala, with 40 questions. Traveled to Imam Malik. And he said to Imam Malik, I have people, yani my people, they send me to ask you these questions. He asked the first question, and Imam Malik said, La adri, I don't know. Imam Malik, he traveled all the Imam Malik said, I don't know. He asked another question, Imam Malik said, I don't know. Ask another question, Imam Malik said, La adri, I don't know. Subhanallah, you look at the Shabab today, he knows everything. The young man, you know, subhanallah, has not even spent 10 years in acquiring knowledge or in implementing it or understanding it. You know, subhanallah, sometimes you get the guy's first year in Medina is learning Arabic, first year in the Arabic college, comes onto internet, Sheikh Fulan. Imagine that. We have seen this wallahi with our own eyes. First year in Medina, comes onto the internet, Sheikh. He was just, the other day was Fulan. Just before he went to Medina, he was so-and-so, you know, Muhammad, Abdul Rahman, Ibrahim, whatever his name was. The moment he reached Medina, Sheikh. Wallahi, this is khatir jiddan. This is a grave danger. That everyone wants to speak. Anyone who can speak wants to speak. Imam Malik ended up answering three questions. Three questions. So the person said, Ya Imam, He said, أنت إمام مالك, you are إمام مالك. I've traveled all the way from my village. My people are awaiting the answers. What must I say to them? He said, go and say to them, Imam Malik says, لا أدري. Go and say to Imam Malik says, I don't know. Wallah, in one direction, he said, go and get up on the hill over there, and you shout to all the people, Malik says he doesn't know. There is no shame in it. Wallahi, to save yourself and refrain from speaking about the deen of Allah without knowledge, there is no shame in it. To direct someone to someone else, to direct someone to a scholar, to a sheikh of ilm, to direct someone to the tulab al-ilm, there is no shame in it. You know, you are not expected to know everything. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, whoever gives you fatwa for everything you ask him, then know that he is majnoon. Know that he is majnoon, there's something wrong with him. How can he give you a fatwa for everything you ask? There must be certain things which escape him, or which he haven't looked into, or which he has not read. So how can he give you fatwa for everything? There's something wrong with this person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from the misguided and misguided muftis. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in beneficial knowledge and grant us the zeal, ayyuha al-ikhwa, to learn the deen of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, so that we know yani the haq from the batil, and that we can return to the Quran and to the sunnah and know that what we're following is what Allah has commanded and what is Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has commanded. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it easy for us to seek knowledge of the deen of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala and to understand it and to implement it and to convey it to others. أقول ما سمعتم وأستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والعاقبة للمتقين والجنة للموحدين ولا عدوان إلا على الظالمين. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله إله الأولين والآخرين وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. عباد الله, يقول الله تبارك وتعالى, الله سبحانه وتعالى says in his book, ولا تقف ما ليس لك به علم إن السمع والبصر والفؤاد كل أولئك كان عنه مسؤولا. الله سبحانه وتعالى says, and do not follow that which you don't have knowledge of. Do not follow that which you don't have knowledge of. Some of the ulama, they say, ولا تقف, meaning do not say it, do not act by it, do not follow it. And don't indulge in something which you have no knowledge of. For in the sam'a, for indeed the hearing and the sight and the heart, all of that you will be questioned about. All of that you will be questioned about. Our Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam warned us. Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, من كذب علي متعمدا فليتبوأ مقعده من النار. But whoever lies upon me intentionally, then let him take his seat in the hellfire. Like these muftis who say to the people that Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever comes to me when I am dead is like he came to me when I was alive. And subhanallah, I lie against Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Kadhib. And when the person says, tayyib, maybe, you know, I didn't see that it is da'if, although it is in the books, it is there. Then even for the person who even thinks that it is a lie, it is not permissible for you to transmit it from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Man rawa anni, Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever reports from me that which he perceives, that which he see, it seems to him, that it is a kadib alayya fa wa ahadul kadibin. He perceives that it may be a lie upon me, then he's one of the liars. He's one of the liars. You see that the hadith is weak. So this cannot be affirmed from Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and you still quote it, and you still transmit it, and you still tell people it. Why? Because you want to send them for Umrah. want to take them for Umrah. So you come up, you quote this hadith, which is a lie. But whoever comes to me when I'm dead, it's like he came to me when I'm alive. Next week we're going for Umrah. Right, so we're going to sell a lot of tickets. Whoever lies upon Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, let him take his seat in the hellfire. Let him take his seat in the hellfire, because he's lying upon Allah and he's lying upon the Rasul of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We must beware, ayyuhal ikhwah. We must not speak about the deen of Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala, that which we don't have knowledge of. Imam al-Qatada, rahimahullah ta'ala, min a'immat al-tafsir, from the Imams of Tafsir, he said, do not say I have seen when you haven't seen. He says the meaning of this, when Allah says to you, don't indulge in what you have no knowledge of. He says, don't say that I have seen when you didn't see. And don't say I have heard when you haven't heard. And don't say I know when you don't know. Don't say I know when you don't know. And here the ulama, they include from that matters which you don't know, is that dhan, is that assumption. I think, I assume it to be like this or like that. That he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, إِيَّاكُمْ وَالظَّنِّ فَإِنَّ الظَّنَّ أَكْذَرُ الْحَدِيثِ. Beware of assumption and suspicion, for indeed, as a dhan, that assumptions and suspicion is the most false of tales. It's the biggest of lies, that I think so and I assume this and I suspect that to be. We must protect our hearing, we must protect our sight, we must protect our hearts from indulging and following that which we don't have knowledge of. Refer back to the people of knowledge. Refer back to those who know the book of Allah and the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and can verify for you the reality and can verify for you the haqq. Even when it is said to you that this is a sunnah or that is a sunnah, or it is sunnah to do this, verify ayyuhal ikhwah. Wallahi, we are in a time that we can't do without verification. We can't do without verification. Imagine in the time of the Tabi'een already. In the time of the Tabi'een, that already it was said, لَوْلَا الْإِسْنَادِ, if it was not for chain of narration, yani of the ahadith and the narrations, لَقَالَ مَنْ شَاءَ مَا شَاءَ, when anyone could say whatever he wanted to. But we have the means of verification, the means of authentication, the means of tahqiq, of investigation and checking, to make sure that what we follow is the commands of Allah and the commands of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We ask that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us beneficial knowledge and righteous actions. Wa nas'aluhu subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allahumma la tada' lana fi jam'ina hadha dhanban illa ghafartah, ولا هما الا فرجته، ولا دينا الا قضيته، ولا مريضا الا شفيته، ولا حقا الا اعليته، ولا باطلا الا ازهقته، ولا حاجه من حوائج الدنيا والاخره الا اعنتنا على قضائها ويسرتها لنا برحمتك يا ارحم الراحمين. اللهم اعز الاسلام والمسلمين، اللهم اعز الاسلام والمسلمين، اللهم اعز الاسلام والمسلمين، ودمر أعداءك أعداء الدين، وأهلك الكفرة والمشركين يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصر المسلمين المستضعفين في فلسطين، اللهم انصر المسلمين المستضعفين في فلسطين، اللهم انصر المسلمين المستضعفين في فلسطين وفي كل مكان يا رب العالمين. اللهم انصرهم على أعدائك وأعدائهم يا رب العالمين. اللهم اغفر للمسلمين والمسلمات والمؤمنين والمؤمنات الأحياء منهم والأموات. اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا، اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا، اللهم اغفر لنا ولوالدينا وارحمهم كما ربونا صغارا. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على نبينا وحبيبنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، والحمد لله رب العالمين.